But if I could just reset a foundation, Mark 11:23.
Yes.
Would y'all go there for a moment, please? I think it's just a must that we visit there. Mark 11:23. Please keep a bookmarker there on Acts the 16th chapter. Mark 11:23. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea. And what does it say? And shall not doubt where?
In his heart.
Shall not doubt in his heart, but shall what?
Believe.
But shall believe what?
That those things which he has said shall come.
Those things which what?
He has said.
Those things which he has what?
Said.
The things that you say,
yes, God.
Not might, not possible, but this is a word of confidence. This is a word of faith uplifting. In what? It shall. Huh?
It shall.
What? Come to pass. And then it says, you shall have whatsoever. Somebody say whatsoever.
Whatsoever.
I say. This is one of the foundational scriptures of this teaching that we've been in there for maybe a good, maybe 8 or 9 weeks or more. Words have life, people.
Amen.
According to John 6:63, words have life. Words are spirit. God is a spirit. According to John 4:24, he's a spirit.
Amen.
It's the spirit of Christ in us, the spirit of life in us, that has us living.
Amen.
So here, I wanted to point out something before we go any further about how you have to identify the spirit of a thing. And the power and authority that you have through what you say can either cause that spirit of a thing to stay there and antagonize you, or stay there and bless you.
Amen.
If time permits, I'm going to show you how God has already ordained and called you and given you and is encouraging you to be a prophet.
Amen.
We as believers do not have to be ordained and consecrated to have hands laid on you and oil poured on your head until it run all the way down to your garment to say that you have been classified by God to be a prophet.
Amen.
I'm going to show it to you.
Amen.
All right? But then there is the office.
Amen.
Of a prophetess or a prophet.
Yeah.
It's a part of the fivefold gift of the calling that God has placed on pastoralship.
Amen.
Okay, so there is a difference. But you have the God-given ability,
yes,
to prophesy. And I'm going to show you how you have the ability to really talk your way out of some stuff.
Amen.
So let's look at this. So it came to pass as they went to pray. And I'm not going to ask y'all how many of y'all really pray.
Amen.
Like you ought to. But anyhow, thank you, Lord Jesus. As they went to prayer, a certain desmo, that means a woman, she was possessed, y'all, with a spirit of divination, met them which brought her masters. Not her. She didn't benefit from it. Are you following me? But those who she was enslaved to. This spirit had a hold on her. She was possessed. She was joined. She was connected to this spirit. And this spirit was called divination. Divination means powers of sorcery or witchcraft, the ability to foretell or foresee and speak certain things.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Speak things that that's to come in the future. But then also it says it was soothsaying, meaning to practice. To practice that demonic spirit of divination.
Amen.
See, the devil has this way of trying to imitate the giftings of God.
Amen.
According to 1 Peter 5:8, the Bible said that he is as a roaring lion.
Amen.
Y'all heard this before. If you've been around here at least a month, you heard this. He's a duplicator. He's an imitator, but the devil is not an authenticator. The only thing that he originates or is authenticator of, that is lying.
Amen.
That is lying. God said in his word, said, you are the father and the author of all lies.
Amen.
So whenever you find somebody who constantly lies, and I know there are times when people will lie out of fear.
Amen.
And you know why they lie? Because the Bible said fear have torment.
Yeah.
Somewhere up here in their sickles, the devil is telling them, well, if you lie, you won't get punished. The consequences won't be so bad. But the devil is already deceived. It's one of his favorite occupations that he operates in, and that is being deceitful.
Amen.
The devil is very deceptive.
Amen.
And when your children operate in deceit, when your children lie, you have to speak to that spirit and call that spirit what it is. Lying and deception.
Amen.
The Bible says that foolishness is bound in the heart of a child.
Yes.
And for those of you that don't like correcting your children, don't like whooping your children, I'm telling you now, you are operating outside of the word of God.
Yes.
He says, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, and the rod of correction would drive Satan,
yes,
the devil, far away.
Uh-huh.
So that means that deception, that foolishness that's bound up in that child's heart, is coming from the devil.
Yeah.
Okay? But you don't beat them half crazy or unto death. You utilize the rod, then you talk to them.
That's it.
You utilize the rod, and then you talk to that spirit.
Yeah.
You lying wonder.
Uh-huh.
You deceiving demon.
Yeah.
I drive you out of my child.
Thank you.
Yes. Now, what's going to happen is, you have self-standing in the presence with that child that when they lie, then when the lie comes to their mind, they're going to tell the truth.
Amen.
Because they're going to remember them wealth that was left.
Amen,
amen, somebody.
Amen.
Y'all know the story. I told y'all last week when I got from my mom, I was 30-something years old. But let's move on. And watch this. So as a spirit of divination, as a false prophet, the Bible said that she followed the men of God. Follow them, making a scene, a loud noise. These men are truly the men of God, and they will lead you into salvation. Well, she was really speaking the truth.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was speaking the truth, but she had the wrong spirit, y'all.
Amen.
See, y'all got to understand is that the Bible said in James, the 2nd chapter, verse 19, the Bible said that the devil believed, but he also trembled.
Amen.
He believed in the power and authority of the word and of God, but see, he trembled because he knows one day he has to face the one,
yes,
who's going to cast him into the pit, the lake of fire, where he's going to spend eternity.
Amen.
Now let's get something straight right now. The devil is not in hell.
Amen.
Amen.
The devil is not in hell.
Amen.
Amen.
He is the prince of the air.
Amen.
Are you following me? Every state, every region, every borderline has a different prince of the air called a principality.
Amen.
A spiritual wickedness stronghold over that state.
Amen.
Down south, you find a lot of states that have a spirit of prejudice. All right, let's not talk about staying your ground. Okay, let's not talk about staying your ground.
Yeah.
All right? Let's not talk about out in the Midwest, where they call it the Bible Gateway, where there's a murdering demon with young people going into schools and just shooting folk up.
Uh-huh.
Hello?
Yeah.
It's a spirit that's lurking over that state that when they find a place, a place that will be a host that they can live in and dwell in and operate through, that's what they do.
Amen.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
But when you look at verse 18, let's look at verse 18. Let's move a little further. Verse 18 says, and this did she many days, but Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say to the damsel. He spoke to the
spirit.
Spirit. He spoke to that spirit of divination, of soothsaying. And he said what? He said, I command thee.
Yeah.
I command thee. Command means to send a strong message or to order or to send a charge.
Yeah.
I command thee, but look at how he commanded. I command thee not in the name of James. Not in the name of Peter or Paul, but I command thee in the name that's above every name, and that is in the name of Jesus. And so often people, we talk to the devil. Folks sit around and have lunch, brunch with the devil. And then once you get tired of the devil using you and abusing you, then you want to tell the devil, leave you alone. Satan, flee. Satan, I rebuke you. And he don't go nowhere because he knows that really you're not operating in the authority.
Amen.
The devil knows how much time you spend and don't spend in Christ during the week, people.
Amen.
He ain't stupid. He's a spirit also.
Amen.
And then you don't understand why certain things aren't operating for you. And when you realize that, okay, I got to do this in the name of Jesus, okay, what you're doing is all of a sudden you decide you want to operate in the name of Jesus, but you have not been building up the spirit of Christ in you down through the week. Come on, gamblers. Gamblers spend time gambling. Come on. Whores, pimps, and prostitutes spend time out on the corner. Sometime every day, if I can say it like that. These children who are learning how to type in my class, they're typing faster than I do because I got to start doing what I'm teaching them to do. They spend time every day on a tutorial program called Maybe Speaking. And they're typing 65 to 75 words a minute. And I'm taking out 8 words an hour. What am I saying? They're spending time in it. The missus and I, and him, I said pastor, the missus, my wife,
amen,
my honey buddy, we got up, man, we was in the street all day long, man, we got home, it was about 10 something, I said, baby, we'll come across the highway, I said, baby, we've been out all day long. Then when I got home, I had a little honey do this to do something that was helpful for today. And everything that we were doing yesterday was for the ministry.
Amen.
See, our life is sold out to this.
Amen.
When I told her the other day, I said, while we ride, I said, I'm just enjoying being with you, girl. Are you with me every day? No, I'm with you at the school. I'm with you at church. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
Come on, I'm with you shopping. I'm talking about just you and... No, I'm not with you. I'm talking about just you and me.
All right.
You know what I'm saying? Or either you and me and Lily. I'm talking about you and me. Not you and me and Lily. Not you and me and them crying children. Not you and me and them high-head saints.
All right.
So I'm just enjoying with the top down, leaning to the side, holding on to my honey. Okay? So I was enjoying it. Okay? I was enjoying it. But what the point I'm getting to is, you got to start spending time with the name of Jesus before you start using the name of Jesus. That's why it ain't working for you. Here's one of y'all talking to me. I'm not. Thank you, man. Holy Ghost told me.
Thank you, Lord.
He'd have been so wise. Trying to use some wisdom. But he commanded them.
Yes, he did.
He said, I command thee. See, you got to be precise of who you're talking to.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
You got to get it for some of you all, whoever the shoe fit, wear, okay? You have to get in the mirror and say, I command you, you selfish demon, get out of me.
Amen.
Get out of me.
Amen.
And all y'all that selfish in here, you better go home and do it today. Because see, the demon of self, all it does is bring stuff, and you're just concerned about you.
That's right.
Yeah, I got some folk I'm going to have to deal with in this ministry. Because see, when it's something that... How often do we give up of our time, ourselves, for the sake of doing something for others as the Lord has guided and directed us to.
That's
Think about it. Think about it. One thing that I've learned about pastoring myself down through the years, and this is not to boast, but just to boast in the name of Jesus, the Christ in us, is that we have always been great givers. And I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about clothes and stuff. What am I digging in? Deacon Riddick can testify to the fact, I don't know how far back it was, gave this brother a diamond cluster ring. Now, I ain't going to tell you all the in details of it. But there were some people told me, man, you was a fool. You could have took that ring, man, and got a couple hundred dollars for it. Yeah, I could have, but I was there in my heart to bless my deacon.
Right.
And I don't think that, you know, there's a possibility it can happen. But for right now, up to this day, this moment, and this hour, there is not a man or a woman in this mission that has royally, honorably served this ministry and the leadership of it.
Amen.
Like Deacon Turbin.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I can't tell you, thank you, Pastor. I can't tell you about all that's coming.
Thank you, Lord.
And then you name one. And all the brother in you right now, you ought to be one to give him the rub his pain all up on you or something like that. And you know, and I hear people use the term, that's my deacon. That ain't your deacon. Stop saying it. Because if it was your deacon, you'd be following his footsteps.
Amen.
All you brothers, you men, man, we going to talk. We going to be, because see, we have to realize that we set the standard. But let's get back to the teaching, okay? And watch this, man. Thank you, man. I appreciate that. I give you a check after service. Now I can read that in Jesus' name. I ain't giving you no check after service. I just put it. No. So he says, in the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. And we know his name is not Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The name is Jesus.
Amen.
All right? But Christ is the operating of anointing upon his life.
Right.
Christ, the anointed one, the power, the submerging spirit of God that's upon his life to get the job done.
That's right, huh?
When you say, oh, that person is anointed, anointed, what they're saying is that they have been empowered by God with a spirit to get the job done. Oh, she's an anointed speaker. She's an anointed singer. He's an anointed drummer. What are they saying? They have the spirit of Christ to drum. They have the spirit of Christ to sing or to teach or to preach.
Amen.
And then there are some who just gifted.
Yeah, some people can just sing.
See, there's a difference between being a gifted preacher, gifted singer, and a gifted drummer.
Yeah. That's it. It's a big difference.
But see, when the anointing is there,
yeah.
Hello, y'all, the anointing causes a change. The anointing brings about a difference. Why? For the Bible said that when the anointing is present, burdens are lifted and yokes are destroyed.
Yeah.
Things change. They can't stay the same. Somebody shout, when the anointing is present.
Thank you, Lord.
So because of the anointing, when he commanded them, watch this, to come out of her, and he came not then, not later, but instantly, you see it? Came out the same hour. The same hour. And when her master saw that, verse 19, and when her master saw that the hope of their gains, their profit, their benefit was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and threw them into the marketplace unto the roots. Now the rest of the story, they end up being jailed. Because when you go back and read the previous chapters, they were told to stop teaching and talking about this Jesus.
Yes.
See, and this is what the devil don't want. He don't mind you talking about God. Why? Because your hair could be your God.
Amen.
Your occupation could be your God.
Amen.
You're cutting your grass. Brother James and Deacon Riddick came out to the house to help me boost a friendship the other day. And my great dear neighbor, a young European brother, was over there working in the yard. And this guy, he sweats, he labors, he toils over his grass daily.
Yes, he does.
And James said, "Boy, he really take good care of that yard, don't he?" I said, "Yeah, brother, you just don't know half of it. That Yah is his God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is.
That Yah is what he worships.
Yeah.
There's another fella at the other end of the street in the cul-de-sac who's out there two or three times during the week polishing.
Yeah.
Washing and polishing the cones and taking the Q-tips and getting all down the crack and crevice. And I said, my God, if people would spend that kind of energy and time in reading the Word,
amen,
giving their life to Christ. But see, here we go. The devil don't mind you saying God because your car can be your God. Some of y'all's children are God. Your wife, your dog can be your God. But the thing about the name of Jesus,
amen,
the power and authority in the name of Jesus is what really moves the enemy.
Amen.
Somebody shout Jesus.
Jesus!
Come on again, shout Jesus.
Jesus!
You know, you can be at home, man, and you can be depressed, oppressed, hung down so much that you don't have no breath. But if you keep on saying Jesus,
uh-huh,
keep on saying Jesus,
yeah,
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 keep on saying Jesus, something's gonna happen. Gonna get straightened in order and be focused. Hello, somebody. That broken heart, man, whatever the situation is, Jesus is gonna come in, apply the balm of Gilead to your heart, and the next thing you know, you ain't even thinking about it no more. You ain't wondering about it no more. You ain't feeling the effects of it no more. Why? Because Jesus is the ultimate authority and power that has the name that's above every name. I don't care what the name is. That name is above the name of whatever it is. The neighbor's a neighbor.
Neighbor?
I don't know about you.
I don't know about you.
But I got to try this.
I got to try this.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh God.
Thank you,
Lord. Touch the button and something happen here and I'll be a funny one.
Thank you.
Oh, somebody start praying. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Glory to God.
Jesus.
All right. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
That's technology for you. Hallelujah. But get this piece. Those who benefit from her being bound up and twisted up and tangled up left her.
That's right.
Got upset.
Yeah.
See, catch this. Catch this, y'all. Catch this. Catch this. Come on, I want everybody to do your hand like this. And grant it. Some folk have got the courage to do things to help them. When you take a stand,
go ahead,
and begin to confess who you are,
that's right,
whom you are,
yeah,
and let folk know who brought you from where and
that's
where
right
you are,
that's right,
amen.
Watch out.
The devil will come test you.
Come on,
yeah,
yeah,
on trial,
oh yes,
to see if you really, really believe and you really mean that you trying to live this life in Christ.
Yeah.
Amen. Okay, it may be your mom. Remember now, according to 1 Corinthians 2:11, be not ignorant of Satan's devices. Hello, except he can get an advantage of us. Come on, we know a device is a noun, and a noun is the name of a person, place, or thing, or I've learned this new grammar is also idea. Hello, PBA!
Amen.
Name of a person, place, or thing. Name of a person, name of a place, name of a thing or idea, so it's the name of the idea.
Yeah.
Amen.
What's the name of the idea? Suicidal.
Mm-hmm.
What's the name of the idea? Idea. Remember, I told you the devil comes to your mind with a thought, idea, or suggestion.
Uh-huh.
Idea, thought, or suggestion of fornication.
Come on, come on.
That's a name.
Amen.
The name of adultery.
Come on.
The name of verbal abuse. The name of low self-esteem, someone who does not believe or have any encouragement in themselves about themselves.
Yeah.
That's it.
So you got to get in the mirror. Whatever that spirit is that you're operating in, you have to speak to that spirit of low self-esteem and say, hold up, for the Lord is my shepherd. Come on, I have been wonderfully and beautifully fashioned and made in the image of God, so I don't care what I look like naturally, spiritually, I'm beautiful. Because here comes the King of Glory. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord God Almighty and the Lord God Almighty in battle, who lives on the inside of me. So he's mighty and mighty in battle. Then I'm strong and mighty in this battle of my mind.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
But you got to learn and find out and identify what that spirit is that you're operating in. Then ask yourself, how could that spirit find room in me?
Amen.
All right. See, you got to talk to yourself. I got to bring this to a close. I want to show you something in Ezekiel, the 37th chapter.
Thank you, Jesus.
You have to talk to yourself.
Yes, you do.
Can I give y'all a revelation? It ain't all that deep. Where is Jesus sitting right now, y'all? On the throne in heaven, but where is he precisely seated? The Bible said where? He's sitting where? On the right hand of God. Okay? Okay? Come here, I'm here. Give me them two chairs right there. Just sit right here. Shut him up. Give them two chairs. Sit. Ezekiel 37 chapter. Heaven, give what other shit. Just sit right there. Sit right here.
Thank you, Father.
What did I say, y'all?
Yes,
I didn't say. Okay, go to start at 4, and I want to end up. I might jump around because I'm gonna show y'all something in verse 12. But I want you to start at verse 4. All of it's good.
Amen.
Come on, God. Have a seat. Now, Jesus is who in the earth? Huh? He's the Lord, he's the Son of God, but he is God, come on y'all, revealed in human flesh. That was the only, y'all better get it, I'm trying to teach you something. That was the only way God could come down here and deal with stanky man.
Amen.
See, when he made us, he didn't make us to be stinking legs, stinking men and women.
Amen.
He made and created us in his image and his likeness spiritually. Then he formed us. Remember the eloquent teaching that we got from our pastor? He formed us from the dust of the earth.
Yeah.
Okay?
Amen.
And then he what he did was as he carved us and shaped us, the imagery and likeness of him was when he blew his spirit into that dust. Into that clay, and then man became a living soul.
Amen.
God, help me, Holy Ghost. Then we became a living entity.
Amen.
After he put his spirit, you ain't alive. You might be walking around, but you a dead man walk. You ain't really living until you start to walking in the spirit of Christ that God has put inside of you. You're operating in death.
Amen.
Everything around you is dead.
Amen.
Everything you touch is dead.
Yes.
Until you come to yourself like the prodigal son. That's the revelation of the prodigal son. He came back to himself in the